Okay, it seems to be time. You're in a session which is about VMware vSphere, so if you're a fervent Hyper-V fan, I don't think this is a session for you. But rest assured, we will be touching a lot of PowerShell. In fact, it will only be PowerShell, but in this case, especially for this kind of environment. And I'm amazed after the Irish pub and other beer crawls yesterday evening of the number of people in this room. I'm afraid I have two sessions. This one is a bit deeper than the next one. So if you wake up before the next one, that's fine with me. Okay, let's get this thing on the road. There's quite a bit of slides. Sorry, I'm sitting down. I'll try to get up, but there's no pointer in any case. So I'm afraid I don't have a lot to show you unless finger pointing here. What we're going to do, there's this vSphere DSC module, which I've been working on for the last year or two. It progressed. That's what I'm going to show you, how it evolved over time. I'm also going to try to explain the concept that I use, because there are some tricks you have to use. You're not going to install an LCM agent on a hypervisor, ESXi hypervisor, nor on your vCenter, I hope. There are a few things, because PowerShell and especially DSC is progressing as well. I profited every time from when they went from 4 to 5 to 5.1. Every time they add some features that come in very handy if you're writing a DSC module for a somewhat foreign resource. I'll try to give you an overview of what is in the module. We zoom in on a few of these. And then I'll close off by showing you a reverse method. This is the one where you have an existing vSphere environment. How am I now going to get this under DSC control? I'm working on that one as well. So it's not only the DSC module, it's also generating automatically, semi-automatically, the configuration files that you would use with the DSC module. Okay, the history. Why did I ever start writing a vSphere DSC module? Now, since a couple of years, software-defined data centers is a hot topic in the IT environment. And in my opinion, and a few others, if I understood it correctly, software-defined data center is exactly this. We'll end up with flat text files, your configuration files, more specifically the configuration data in there. So you have those flat files, and that is what actually is software-defining your data center. In this case, it's aimed at a vSphere environment, but still, that's one of the concepts that in my opinion is quite important in a SDDC environment. So the first presentation I gave on this subject was in VMworld 2015. I also published the first public version on GitHub. I think there's a blog post even on that. Then when PowerShell 5 arrived, it was a lot easier. In fact, I switched at that point, like we will see later, completely to classes. And I can take that away. We'll go deeper in that later, but I'm completely taken away by classes. It's very handy if you want to do this kind of module building, DSC resource module building. We tried last year in two of the hackathons that are organized at VMworld to write a resource while the hackathon was going, which was 3 hours, I think, but it's definitely too short. 3 hours. So we got somewhere, we didn't get a success in the hackathon. But in any case, I had a lot of people in the team participating, and it was quite interesting to get the feedback from other people on developing resources for a rather complex environment like vSphere. Then one of the good news items I have is that PowerCLI, they started with 6.5 release 1. It became a module. And in the latest one, which is out, what, 3 weeks, 4 weeks about, they now have it in the PS gallery. So it's location independent, no more MSI files. Just do an install module, a find module, install module, and you have PowerCLI available. It's still not completely there. 5.1 again brought some advantages that PowerShell 5.1 brought some advantages that I could use in my module, but there's still some small things missing, for which we have bypasses, as we can see later. Now the concept I mentioned before, vSphere is a closed environment, or you should treat it at least as a closed environment. For those of you who still have vCenter running on a Windows box, you could consider installing an LCM agent on that vCenter host. But since we are moving more and more to the appliance type of vCenter VCSA, and then next to it, the ESX iNode, the hypervisor itself, you're not definitely not installing stuff on there. You should consider that as a closed box. Don't touch it. So what I did is I needed to be able to configure that environment. What I did is, and that's what you see here, I used the machine, and in the beginning it was a straightforward Windows box. This is this vEngine here. A straightforward Windows box core, and I installed an LCM agent on there. And that's, in fact, the one that I registered under DSC. That is the one where I pushed the configurations towards. And in the module, through the API that vSphere offers, I could make changes to and the vCenter and the ESXi, the hypervisor. I could use the same code because, as you know or don't know, but vSphere APIs, the SDK for vSphere, uses the same kind of methods, properties, and so on. If it's for a hypervisor, a standalone hypervisor, for example, or if it's for a vCenter. So, yeah, we can use the same calls, the same methods for both types of environments. Although I'm not sure who is actually running standalone ESXi nowadays. Are there any in the audience who do that? No. Most of you are using a vCenter, as you should probably. So the concept is quite straightforward. The vEngine, in the meantime, became an appliance thanks to the PowerShell core and PowerCLI core. So I can use whatever small server I have there, and Nano, for example, and you install the core on there and you run your LCM agent in that environment if need be. So you can slim it down. I even have a test set up where I run the engine on the same server as the pool server. That's a test environment. Don't do that in your production, but you could limit your footprint of the environment that you're using there. Okay, this recaps a bit some of the decisions I had to take along the path. I already explained that we use this proxy server, the vEngine, to be able to talk with the vSphere environment. The other thing that I decided was classes. I did that when 5 was just out. In fact, I already did that when 5 was an RTM. Why did I use classes? First of all, the inheritance, as we will see later on, is quite a handy feature. I'll give you some examples how you can use that to your profit if you're writing a DSC module. And the second one, you don't have this complex module structure where you have to have schemas and so on. So with classes, the LCM generates the MOFs on the fly. So that's a quite simple environment in my opinion as well. That's the primary reasons why I went to classes. Now classes are, in my opinion, not yet a 100% valid. And there we have it. Thank you. There is still some features that are not exactly working with classes as they should with scripted resources. Now, another decision, and we'll come back to that later. I mentioned the vSphere API. Why did I use the vSphere API? Because first of all, it's faster. Most of the time, it's faster than your regular PowerCLI commanders. That doesn't mean you can't develop your new resources in PowerCLI. You can prototype. PowerShell, PowerCLI is an excellent prototyping language. If you want faster code, you go to direct API calls, and who knows, in the future you could do it in C# or whatever once your concept is working. So prototyping, very well done in PowerShell/PowerCLI. Now, one of the pitfalls, and as you see there, it's already solved by the 6.5R1 release where they became module only. When they had snap-ins have some very strange characteristics, or better said, LCM has some very strange behaviors when it's a snap-in. You can't load that in the same module, so you have to do that in a module outside of your DSC resources. Use dot sourcing, not very pretty to look at, but it works. But that thing is solved in the meantime. So with 6.5R1 from PowerCLI, I can now use the autoload feature since it's a full module. What I also did in the latest version, as we will see later on, there's a lot of reference material where they always say You have to sign your scripts. You have to encrypt your credentials if you're doing configuration files. And that's a good thing. You should do that, in fact. But none of the books I consulted actually contained code or real examples how to do that. So in the version I'm going to publish shortly, you will find some examples how you do both things. Encrypt your credentials, because you will be sending along credentials to your vSphere environment, but also you will be signing. So you're avoiding that somebody, some wild station on your network is spoofing and sending configurations to your vSphere environment. So I added a security layer on top of what I already had. One of the things that is open, and I had a nice talk with Jeffrey and Bruce on that, the LCM, when he reads a module, the module is read through the using modules statement that was introduced in 5.1. That is a great addition. But the problem there is I can use now, when I do that, the commandlets that are available in PowerCLI, but I can't use the types that are defined in the PowerCLI modules. Why? Because they are defined in DLLs, and those DLLs are loaded through a required assembly statement in the manifest of the module. So I have a bypass for that. Again, I put that in a separate file, do the dot sourcing, and in this way, I can use the PowerCLI types directly in my source code. So as you can see, we are not there yet, but it's moving along. Now, if you write or start writing a DSC resource module for whatever environment, you should know the environment that you're writing against. For most of the Microsoft environments, that's quite straightforward, but I can imagine that you use other targets. I did that with vSphere. I could imagine that you're running or writing a DSC module against the Cisco environment. So one of the things that you need to know is how does this environment look? Because this is something, you should map that environment before you actually start writing. And what we see here is one of my schematic views on a vSphere environment. And what you can see very well in there is that vSphere progressed over time. So at the moment we are at version 6.5, but there are relics in there from 3 and 4 and 5, and they don't always rewrite their complete code, because these releases would otherwise take quite a bit longer to appear. And there are some very intrinsic things in there that could cause problems when you're writing a resource module. For example, if you look at the folder structure, everybody knows a folder structure, a folder in vSphere environment. But since recently, there are four types of those. You have the ones where you store your hosts. You have the ones where you store your VMs. Same for storage and same for network. Now, network, that is already an exception. If we look at the original switches that they had, which is the standard switch, the virtual standard switch, that one doesn't appear in that folder because that was already there before they introduced, for example, the network folder. What you see in the network folder are the distributed switches. They were an addition later on. So I'm not trying to point at all the issues there, but you have to know your environment and know the intrinsic differences that are there and take that into account when you're writing your code. So a good suggestion there, if you're going to code against a rather complex environment, make sure you have a map that you know how everything fits together and links together. That is quite important to actually write the resources later on. Okay, this is one more example in here where you have some very strange things happening. You would think that if you, the vSphere environment is a tree, and you can represent it in a tree structure. You would think you can uniquely identify such an object in there by one path through that tree structure. Now, that is not true. Some of these things, and you see that here by two arrows arriving, for example, at the VM. You can reach a VM if you go through the hypervisor folder, the ASX host folder, but you can also reach a VM through the VM folder. That's the famous thing, what they used to call, it's not there in 6 anymore, the blue and the yellow folders you had in a vSphere environment. So you need at least two paths to uniquely locate a VM in your environment. So that's another thing that you have to take into account while you are coding your DSC resource modules. This is how I implemented this in the code. And here you also see where the classes come in quite handy. This is already a preview of what I will show later on with the inheritance of classes. At the top, at the left there, for the one, I hope you can all see it. It's a screenshot from VS Code, Visual Studio Code. I start with a base class, which has some properties that all my objects in the DSC resource module have. There's things like the name, the path. The path is the general one. That is the one going through the host folder, correct? But then if you go further on, and I gave an example here of a standard switch, which is based on the base class, I need to add a second part, a second property in there, where I actually locate where that virtual switch is located in the network folders, the network part. VSS is a bit different because they are not actually there, so you have to pass through an ESXi node, which we will tackle or show later on in the presentation. So just be aware, there are a few things that you have to catch or trap in your code and take that into account to have a working version of your module. Then this is another thing that mixes up quite a lot of people who start working with Power CLI in the beginning. You can have objects with the same name X number of times. I did an example here. I call it, this is a folder. I called it same name, but as you can see, it's four different objects in your environment. And you can see that by the type column to the right. So I have one folder in my host and cluster branch, one in network, one in VM, one in data store. So again, proof that you actually need the complete path information to actually locate your objects in the environment. So that again translates into your class properties that you define. What is interesting, and this is also new when you go to 5, is this top right thing here, the enumeration. So you don't have to do a lot of if-then-elses. You can now work with enumeration, which is known in coding environments. You just give a number of possible values that this type, enum type, can have in your code. So in this case, I defined, and you can see that at the bottom right, the folder type is one of those four that I specified in the enumeration. So another thing great for working with classes. One of the basic things is if you now specify a new object through the configuration file, you have to be able to pinpoint exactly where you want to first test and eventually create that object. So traversing your inventory tree is quite an important code, part of the code in your complete DSC resource module. So that's a separate function in the module, locate your objects or where they need to go quite accurately based on the properties that you specify for the object. I'm not going to go into the code. It's small print. I'm sorry about that. Once it's published, you will be able to probably read it a bit better than over here. Sorry. A bit on the module itself. I tried to put a certain structure in there, which is quite simple, thanks to the classes I'm using. So I just have the code itself. It is a PSM1 file. I have a manifest. And then you see this helper file, which is a regular PS1 file. That's the one where I put all my Power CLI code. I already mentioned that there are some issues if you want to use types in your code. You can only do that when the module is actually loaded, the Power CLI module. So I solved that by using it in a separate PS1 file. Now, most of my resource classes that I defined are identical. The structure is identical. So you see these 1, 2, 3 dots on the right screenshot there. So first you have the properties, then you have the standard thing. You will find this in any DSC blog post or article. You have your properties, you have your standard test, get, and set functions that you need to define. And then I did some helper functions, and we'll see in a minute why I introduced those. This is what I just explained. Some of that Power CLI code, where I'm actually using Power CLI, I put it in that separate file, and I dot source that file in my main module file. That way I will be able to use all the Power CLI types in my code. So this is just a handy trick if you need something that is not at the moment accepted through LCM, because the rest of it definitely accepts it, and you can work with it. Okay, this is an example of these classes that I used. In this case, and we already showed in the beginning that we have this base class on the left. Base class has some very straightforward properties that you need to define. There's a name for your object, there's a path, one path. There's the state of the thing. Does it need to be there? Does it not need to be there? Absent in this case. And there's a few others. The vCenter server on which it needs to be defined, because the DSC resource module is written that you can use it from the same configuration files towards multiple vCenters in the same config file, if you ever would feel the desire to do that. So that's the basic thing. Now, if I, for example, and I use the example of data stores in here, if I now need to have a class for data stores, I first of all do an inheritance. That's you see that at the top line, I inherit from the base. So all the properties from the base are in there. I add a few properties specific for data stores. And ultimately, on the right, for a specific type of data store, in this case, an NFS data store, I add some more properties, like, for example, which NFS host, what version, how do you connect to the NFS server and the share. So this is one of the big advantages of using classes. You can define your structures in a very organized way thanks to this inheritance concept. So if you ever go for a rather complex DS series, I strongly advise to go for classes instead of normal classical scripted methods. Diving in a bit further, so we just saw the properties. These are the basic functions, like I mentioned, the test, set, get. They should be there in every DSC resource. With the class-defined resource, it's quite straightforward. These are methods that you define in your classes. Now, why did I do those helper functions that I mentioned earlier? That's because I want to keep this structure quite simple. So what you will find in my, let's take the, is it the test one? Yeah, in the test here, I only do the logic because the test method actually needs to return a Boolean, so true or false. You have a DSC resource, you specify it if it should be absent or present. The test will look what the state of that resource is. So it returns, is it there, true, is it not there, false. And this is just the straightforward logic in four branches with an if-then-else structure where I return one of these Boolean values. So this is quite straightforward, and in fact this looks somewhat the same for most of the resources. So if you want to add a resource, you just copy this stuff and you fill in the blanks at some points where it is required. These ones you hardly have to touch ever. Now, this was all before. It was all straightforward PowerShell, no Power CLI involved yet. Now we come to the step in the some of the functions where we actually are going to use Power CLI. And in those helper functions, one of the things I do is make that Power CLI environment available. Like I said before, I do that by calling all functions where I actually use Power CLI. You call those, because they're located in that PS1 file, like I said, I call these in those helper functions. So this is a bit more specialized. These functions in the class, in this case, it's an example for a cluster, they are very specific. For example, we are going to look on the cluster. Does it need to have high availability, DRS, DPM, and does vSAN need to be activated? So this code that you put in here in the helper functions in the class, they are quite specific for each type of resource that you're writing against. So this is where we make the... But there is no Power CLI code yet on this level. This is all pure PowerShell. And then we dive one further. I mentioned this now several times. All my Power CLI code is actually in that PS1 file. In this case, I'm using the APIs. I'm not actually using Power CLI commanded. Now, the vSphere API can be a bit daunting in the beginning, but once you get the hang of it, it's quite straightforward. You compose your specifications, and in the end, okay, here, you actually call the method which will implement. Now, this is in fact, in a lot of lines, doing the same thing as what your new cluster commandlet would do. Difference is I have a bit more control on what I'm actually doing here. Why would I do it this way? Speed is one thing. Okay, for a new cluster, it's not a big deal, but there are other commandlets or other resources where this could become a big deal. Why is, for example, the Power CLI command not always giving me all the options? And that is something that you should remember all the time. The Power CLI commandlets are following this 80%, 20% rule. So the Power CLI commandlets try to cover 80% of your needs, your normal needs as a vSphere administrator. For that 20% of special things you want to do, there you would need to go to the APIs. Now, luckily, from the beginning, they foresaw that you could easily call these APIs. There's the getView commandlet that everybody should know who uses Power CLI. And a bit later on, they added also the extension data in the objects where you can look at the vSphere properties. Not the .NET properties, but the vSphere properties. But remember, that's a read-only copy. Don't change it on there, that won't work. So this is in the special helper file, the PS1 file that I dot source in the DSC resource module. Now, the configuration files for DSC, and this is a solid principle, this is nothing specific for vSphere environments. You should do that all the time. You should separate your what from your where. One of these is quite straightforward. I hope you can see it. Yeah, I didn't expand them. On the left, this is the code that is the same everywhere. Whatever your environment is, this is just going to look, is there a request for a data center, is there a request for a folder? And where you actually specify the data, that the properties of the object you want to create, that you do in these configuration data blocks. There we're actually going, no, sorry, this is what is happening in one of those. I was one slide too soon. So it's rather general. It picks up from your configuration data the specific values in this case. So this code is always the same in your configuration files. If we go now, this is the one I wanted to show. This is where we're actually going to provide values. So here we're actually saying it's in that data center with that name and that type of object I want to create. So that stuff is actually the lines that differ for different vSphere environments. The previous code is the same for every vSphere environment. Now, this will help us later on, because this is actually only the thing that we need to keep to track changes in our environment. Like I mentioned there, this is a straightforward text file in the end. You can put this under source control. You can run diffs on there. And this is where we're actually getting to software-defined data centers. This piece of text defines your data center. vSphere data center in this case, but this would work for every environment. Keep your actual data where you define what you want in a separate file and keep that one under source control. I hope you can see it, but at the bottom here, this kind of data you can put in a separate file as a PSD1 file, and that is in effect the one that you pass on the configuration data. And the rest of it, of your configuration files, can be identical wherever or whatever you want to define. This is the one that changes for every environment. So this makes it quite manageable to control a rather complex environment by just putting this kind of file under source control. I mentioned earlier security. One of my goals for the newer one, the newer version, was that I wanted to introduce security on two levels. I wanted to sign all the configuration files, but I also wanted to encrypt all the credentials and sensitive information that is going through or is being mentioned in a config file. It will be difficult to see from where you're sitting, probably. The signing, that's what you get at the end of each of your configuration files. And the credentials, they are encrypted the moment they are sent to your target node, the vEngine in our case. So there's no clear text passwords going on anymore. The only part where you still have clear text, and I'm looking for a solution for that, is, of course, in your configuration file. the one that writes the configuration files, he does need to know the credentials, or he has to find a way to pick them up from a secure source somewhere else. Yes. I could, but there's more than just credentials. There's, for example, also license keys. I also want to protect license keys. So I'm looking, in fact, if somebody has an idea, I'm looking for a more general solution where I can store trusted information. And that is not only credentials, but also license keys. I could even imagine in some environments that your host name domain could be something that you need to secure, that you don't want to have open in the wild in a text file over the net. So it's a bit more complex than just credentials. There's more in there. Yes? Okay, so there's another session apparently who will handle that. But is it only on credentials or is it also... Yeah. Yeah, the encrypted is there, but how would you, would that also encrypt just a string, for example, like a license key?
Yes, it would be data, so whatever the data is.
Okay, great. So when it's published, have a look at that session. I definitely will, because I'm looking for something like that. Great. So you see, we all learned something here. Yes, was there another question? I'm just diving in. This is a small extract of this helper file, this PS1 file, where I do the actual Power CLI command. I mentioned in the beginning that one of the functions that is quite critical in the environment is locating your objects. So as you can see, there are a couple of functions in here where I actually run through the vSphere environment, where I find the object that I'm looking for, or at least the location where the object should be. There's a few other ones. Is the folder correct? Is the parent correct? So these are all quite general functions that are used in finding, most specifically in the test, but also in the set methods later on. So there's some basic functionality that you need to provide in the module. Okay, the demo, I'm not going to do anything live. I learned that by experience that is a bad idea. So I record most of my stuff. It's nothing smashing. What you will see here, and it will go through quite quickly. On the left, that's my update DSC configuration. One thing to remark, put a lot of verbose in there, write verbose in there. It's very handy to follow what is going on. On the right here, you saw an empty vSphere environment. There was just a vCenter. And you will see stuff popping up that is defined in the configuration file. I didn't speed up the video. This is in my home lab, which is not a big resource-based environment, so it's quite straightforward. The only thing I have to hit refresh sometimes, because the refresh rate of the web client is not optimal at some points. But okay, you get the idea. I was looking at Brian, by the way. No, they know that, I think. So you see that stuff is coming up. You see, for example, the two hypervisor nodes that were added to the environment. Why are they with a warning? Because he's setting up the HA, the high availability. So while the HA agent is being installed, those will stay in a yellow state. I'm looking at this point at the data store folders. You see there are data stores defined. I'm looking at the network. You will see the standard port groups that are defined here. You don't see the standard switches, you see the port groups in these kind of... So just to show you that it actually works at the moment. And in fact, what I'm doing is this kind of behavior, this kind of setup. Let me just check if that is the slide that should be coming up. Okay, this is quite interesting. If you need, there are some basic unit pester tests in my module at the moment, but they are quite straightforward, which you can do with any module. What I really are looking for is infrastructure testing. But infrastructure testing for a vSphere environment that you need, that means you need a vSphere environment as a basic. You at least need, for example, a VCSA. You're not going to do this to your life, not even your development environment. You're doing this in a separate greenfield type of environment. So what I used to do in the past, I used Vagrant. Anybody familiar with Vagrant? Okay, it's a kind of tool where you quickly can set up a test environment or any environment. So what I'm thinking at the moment is replacing my Vagrant test setup by actually using DSC configurations to set up my test environment in my passive testing. So it's kind of the eat your own dog food concept that I'm going to use here. I'm actually using the DSC module to set up the environment to test or execute my passive testing for the DSC module whenever I add a resource. The tooling, we'll go a bit further into that in some of the later slides. How am I doing on time? Okay. Yeah, a bit. Okay, this was this is a general thing. At the moment, I do my development in Bitbucket, which is a private repository. There is an older version already on GitHub. After this conference, I will publish my latest version, the ones that you just saw a demo with all the extra resources. I will put it on GitHub so you can all have a look. And there's a call, please start contributing. I don't, in the first instance, want code. If you just have an idea, I would like to see this resource, or it would be handy if we could configure this type of configuration setting from a DSC resource module. That would be handy feedback, because now I'm the one deciding and I'm doing what I think is important, but there's a lot of other users out there that probably have other ideas. Okay, and if you want to contribute the code, like I said before, there's no need to do it via API code. If you do the prototyping in straightforward PowerCLI commands, I have no problem with that. So all contributions, whatever level, are welcome. Doesn't even have to be error-free. I would gladly review it with the one who submits. Again, we touched most of that. The layout of the module is quite straightforward. You have the PSM1, where you have the classic DSC thing in there, and you have the helper function, the PS1 file, where I put all my PowerCLI specific code in there. I'm not going to spend too much on this one here. This is something new. Now you have your DSC resource module, but a lot of us, most of us, are stuck or have already an existing vSphere environment. Now, how are you going to get that under DSC control? Now, you could painstakingly write out your configuration files, but hey, that's against PowerShell. We automate stuff. So I was looking at a way of generating these configuration files from an existing vSphere environment. So you have your vSphere, it was going to read all the stuff, generate that configuration data part for you automatically. And I started doing that at the moment that I'm at 0.9, so it's not really working 100%, but it's doing quite a bit of the stuff I wanted to do. Now, why do we need, and again, we come back on what I said in the beginning. This is one of your basic requirements for a software-defined data center, that you have your configuration in a controllable way, so preferably text files, which you can put under version control, run differences, you can do audits on there. You can even use this to migrate your environment. If you generate a config file like that, and there's, for example, a new naming standard in your organization, just do a global search with PowerShell, of course, and replace the old name by the new name. And then just, there you go, deploy it again. A migration of a vCenter version, you can do it this way. Take your folder structure from the old environment and inject it into your new vCenter environment. So there's tons of possible applications of being able to read your environment and then use it in another environment. Now, this is one of the few occasions where I actually draw out a flowchart for an application, because this was quite complex. And there's a few slides later on each of these components in there, but since we're pressed by time, I think I'm just going to give you the global outline here. There's two things that we start from at the top of the flow. First of all, there's the DSC resource module itself, the PSM1 file. I wrote a small script that is using abstract syntax tree to extract all the properties that I need for each of the classes. We'll see that later. Then I wrote another script, which is doing an extended inventory of your environment, because there is a get inventory command in PowerCLI, but it's not showing you everything. Not everything that I would need to get a configuration file. So I expanded on that one. So that's already two parts of the input I would ultimately need. That's the two, I put them in CSVs, but you can put them in whatever format you want. Then there's the knowledge base. I'll jump into that one later on. And there's the security DB. So if that solution with storing securely information, that could be replacing that right box in the flowchart. Once we have all those resources, we have all the input we need, and then we just go to a script which reads all that, translates it, massages it, and puts it in the correct format to be a DSC configuration file. More specifically, I generate those PMD1 files, the configuration data in this case, and then from there on, it's just running your config, targeting the environment where you want to apply that configuration. Okay. I think I said most of this stuff. So I'm using abstract syntax tree. If you haven't used that before, it's quite interesting. If you have existing larger scripts and you want to do an analysis on there, and I think the PS Script Analyzer is using that as well, you can actually check your code in an organized way by using the AST in this case. I only use it to extract information about my classes. This is part of the code where I actually use the AST code. But what is interesting is what comes out of it. And this is this famous CSV file on the left. So what you will see is I have all my DSC resource classes come out. I see if they have an inheritance somewhere. That's in this column. I can find all the properties. I will see if the property is mandatory and so on, the types. And I even have the location in my file where that property was defined. So this is quite interesting just for bookkeeping, for example. If you're not going to use this reverse module, this could already be interesting to analyze your DSC resource class. And you could use this for any DSC resource class. It's not specific for vSphere DSC. This is a general script which you could use on anyone, any DSC resource module. Inventory Plus, again, an extended version of the get inventory command that is already there. I repeat this drawing, so there's lots of tricky things that you need to know. Like, for example, the boxes on the right where there's more than one arrow arriving, so there's multiple paths to that kind of object. The code is rather straightforward because I used a lot of recursive calling of functions. But what we do is, and this is always, if you want to do an inventory of your vSphere environment, you normally start from your root folder. That's you have the service instance root folder. That's the basic of your complete vCenter controlled environment. So that's where we start. And from there, we descend through the complete vSphere tree, inventory tree, and note down all the specific properties that I want to have for my script later on. What comes out of this thing here, and that's interesting. I thought it was interesting. We have in these columns, we see the multiple paths. Remember, we have the four types of folder paths. So what you get out of here for certain objects, you see that they have more than two paths. Line 14, for example, there's a VM there, and you can locate that VM through the host folder, but you can also locate it through the VM folders, the blue and the yellow folders from the past. So this is actually giving you a lot more than the get inventory command, which is enough for most of your tasks. But for my task, I needed a bit more information. That's why I did this script here. yeah, there's something specific. Some of these older objects, and I mentioned the standard virtual switch already in the past, they were there from quite early in the vSphere environment development. So they are directly located through the ESXi host because they are defined individually on each ESXi host. So there's a few more. You have the some data stores, you have the standard switch, you have port groups and so on. So there's some special parts in the code where I also traverse for each ESXi host I encounter in the inventory. I'm going to find that kind of objects as well. So that's another point where it goes further than the standard get inventory commandlet. Like I said, I take something home from this conference. I'm going to look in this, where can I store something securely? So this is one of the places I will probably be able to use that later on. Now this one here is, we discovered all the properties that you need for a specific class. Now, how are we going to find the values? Because your configuration file not only has the name of a property, but you need to pass a value as well. And I could hard code that in a script, but that would be a few thousand, multiple thousands of lines, and I don't want to do that. So what I did is, or what I came up with, I have a kind of knowledge base which I created. So as you can see, there's the resource on the left, there's the property, the type, and in here, there's two columns that are interesting. In my opinion, there's the way how you get that property value and then the actual instructions how to get it. So there's the type and the actual instructions. Now, what these types do, they allow my script, which will is going to retrieve the values, to find out how we should actually be extracting the values. So as you can see, there are a few in there. There's the fixed, which is a constant value, and so on. There's, for example, also the security database. That's the one where I will have a closer look at the suggested solution. There's calc. There's even can put code blocks in there. That's what the fcalc means in this case. So I have multiple ways of obtaining values for specific properties. This seems to work until now for most of the cases I encountered. Security DB, that's again referring to that, how am I going to securely store credentials, sensitive information, and so on. So this could be solved in the near future. Then ultimately, now we have all our input. That's those four files that we needed. Now I'm actually going to use those four files as input and generate the configuration file, more specifically the configuration data file. And again, like I said earlier, the stuff where we define what classes, what objects should be in the configuration file, that is fixed. The only thing I'm generating is this PSD1 file. That's the one where we actually have properties with specific values for a specific environment. So the only thing that is changing is something like this, the PSD1 file. That's the only one we need to maintain somewhere and version track, version control, and so on. I think I mentioned most of the use cases earlier on, but just to recap here, software-defined data center is controlling your environment, so version control, making differences if you want to know what your colleague did in the latest change. You run a diff between the one from the week before and the one from yesterday, and you will immediately see in the config file what has changed between those two maintenance cycles or whatever you want to call it. Replication is another big use case. I mentioned that I'm intending to replace my Vagrant setup by DSC to set up my Greenfield test environment. Migrations, I also mentioned that. You read your environment. For example, you can filter that you only have the data center and the folder structure, or even further, data center folder structure and permissions on the folders, and you just inject that into your new vCenter, which could be a new version, for example. This is part of your migration. Set up the infrastructure I have there, move it to the new target environment in one run of a script, in fact. Configure it. Upgrades, new platform. If you want to go to the cloud, this is also ideal. You just provide that kind of configuration data to your cloud provider, and he should be able to set it up for you based on whatever underlying hardware he uses there. Okay, I think I handled most of the things that we mentioned. These are the takeaways for the complete session. So every time there's a new release, and from PowerShell and from PowerCLI, I can progress in my DSC resource module. Every time there's a new feature that I could use to make it more slick and faster and easier to code. So new release equals new features. The reason why we would go for DSC-based DSC classes, I think I showed that as well with the inheritance and so on, which makes it quite easy to view how different objects are interrelated in your code. Then with the vEngine concept that I explained in the beginning, if you want to target an external foreign environment which probably can't run an LCM agent, there are ways of doing that through the vEngine, like I did it here. And then what is very important, and I hope I stressed that enough, if you're going to a legacy system, make sure you know the environment you're coding against. So don't be surprised by things, oops, this doesn't work like I thought. Make sure you know the target environment, because legacy systems are most of the time not too logical. Coding in the past compared to coding now is two different kinds of coding, in my opinion. So at the moment, it's more organized and more slick. And it's not only VMware where I see this. I see this from other target platforms as well. Okay, there's a 15-minute break coming up, I understood. Are there any questions? That's the next slide, I think. Yeah, any questions? I know it's a lot. I would be, especially on a Friday morning, after a beer crawl the night before, but if there are no questions at the moment, yep, that's one. Okay, virtual machines is my last DSC resource class I'm going to write, because my concept was, and I know there's somebody else, Dark Operator, who did it differently. He started from VMs and then hard-coded everything in the, I wanted to provide my environment, so I start from data centers, folders, data stores, hypervisors, and my summum where I arrive at the top, that's where I'm going to deploy VMs. At the moment, it's in draft. I don't think it's ready to publish yet, but it shouldn't be that long anymore. And what? Meaning? I know. That's a good point. Scaling is something I haven't considered yet. The problem also is that LCM has one interval. You can't make distinctions. But on the other hand, I heard some good news in a session yesterday that there will be multiple LCM agents possible in the near future. That would be ideal for this. So my hypervisors, I could check every 15 minutes. My VMs, I could do once every 6 hours or something like that. So. And this comes back to one of the key takeaways. New features bring new possibilities for this kind of module. So I'm looking forward. No, I don't have a solution at the moment, but I'm looking forward to new developments. Any more questions? If it's too, I can understand that, like I said, it's a lot, but feel free to ping me Twitter, mail, submit a comment via my blog. And I'll try to respond if I'm not away, like this week in Hanover, for example. There's a summary page. There's a few of my contact points that you can use there. You can even raise something on the VM community, as far as I'm concerned. I don't think VMware will mind if you ask something about community contributions there. Thank you. Ah, yeah. For those who are into PowerCLI, Brian Graf brought some PowerCLI posters. Don't rush the table here, but there are a few. Unfortunately, I don't think there's enough for everybody in the room. There's some stickers as well, or are they at the...
I already put stickers, I think, on pretty much every scene. Aaron, I still have some more of you. If one, and then I'll put
some out for your next session. Well, so for your VMware-related goodies, see Brian. Posters are here. Go ahead. Thank you. Ah, sorry. I'm going to switch this off. But one of the reasons why you could also go to DSC, this will run in a standard vSphere license. Yeah. You don't need Enterprise Plus anymore.
Okay.
So there are some financial advantages as well.